before we get started with worship, please attend the Angel Tree Wrap and Delivery Day. It's on Saturday, December 10th, so next Saturday. Wrapping starts at 10 a.m. and delivery is at noon. Please come and join in the fun, whether you bought a gift or not. Details are in your bulletin. Drivers for Gummy need to be here at the church by 4:30 today to leave.
And
we still need drivers. Okay, we still need drivers. We also have two drivers that committed that will be here, but they do have a conflict. So if anyone else wants to step in and fill that slot, talk to Beth or Jason Cornell or Kelly Sisko. Buckeyes, fudge, candy, and more. Come down to the fellowship hall after worship and see all the goodies that are for sale. A big thank you to everyone who helped make our holiday cookie and candy sale a big success, and that's from the Lillian Faith Circle. Poinsettia orders are due today, so if you want poinsettias, please fill that out, put it in the offering plate, put it in the offering plate. Due today. Angels, lambs, ladybugs, and fireflies. This year's version of Stepping Back in Time is looking to be a great time with a great message. We have a full run through today right after worship, and I'll talk to you, all of you then about some music rehearsals possibly this Wednesday night, but be here. The program is actually on December 18th. That evening, 6 o'clock, refreshments on the lawn, 7 o'clock, program here in the sanctuary. And your Advent devotionals, there are still plenty of Advent devotionals available in the back. Those are devotionals that were written by the congregation members. Pick one up. We're asking for a dollar donation to help offset the cost. If you feel so inclined, there's a basket there to put a dollar in. Read all the rest of your announcements in your bulletin. I think Pastor Chip has something he's going to speak about.
Just a reminder, confirmation class, we were going to meet right after worship, but we're going to do a change. We're going to meet at 2 o'clock, and then that way we'll run right up to the dummy time. You won't have to come, go back home, come back here again. So confirmation at 2 o'clock. This is our last class, and the class we brought in then on Sunday, December 18th. And then speaking about membership, just make sure you note there, we also have a new members class. It's meeting next Sunday, so make note of that if you're interested. Thanks.
Now please prepare your hearts for worship as we listen to Nancy's prayer.
Thank you.
first Sunday of Advent, we lit the first candle, which is the candle of hope. We saw that even as the light of this candle dispels the darkness, so Jesus came into the world to dispel our darkness, and in so doing, gives to us hope. May this candle be a reminder to us that we are called to let His light of hope shine through us, that others might find it as well. And so again, we light that first candle, the candle of hope. This morning we come to light the second candle of Advent, the candle of love, and as we do, we have another brief video that's going to introduce this candle. We thank you, O God, for the love that is ours in your Son, Jesus. Help us, we pray, to experience anew this Advent season, this amazing love that redeems us and calls us into relationship with you. Help us to allow this love to be the driving force in our lives, that we might love others even as you love us. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, the one who first loved us. Amen. We're going to sing our Advent song, Love Came Down at Christmas.
Thank you.
prepare our hearts for our prayer time, I want to draw your attention to the prayer concerns you find printed in your bulletin on the back of the sermon notes page. Please be mindful of each of these. They stand in need of prayer not only today, but throughout the week as we go to the Lord in our personal prayer times. We're happy to report that Jean Ann had her surgery and is recovering well and is, looks like, coming home tomorrow. And so continued prayers for not only her, but Jenny and several others that are still recuperating. Jim Molinas continues to be in Mount Carmel East Hospital. And again, each of these equally stand in need of prayer. If you have additional prayer concerns, the yellow cards you have in your bulletin can be used to register those. This can also be used for your attendance, and that is extremely helpful to us. So if you would please utilize that, we would appreciate that. But as we sing our prayer song and enter into our prayer time, we'll be collecting the cards and bringing them forward. Again, the front here is always open for a time of prayer, but where we find ourselves as well is an altar before God. So the important thing is that we be open to the leading of the Spirit in this holy moment. Let's sing together as we enter into our prayer time.
Some of you may not know this beautiful hymn, so we're going to sing through the first time. If you do know it, join us. And if you don't, then listen and join in the second.
We commend to you each of these we have on our prayer list, those that we have on these cards as additions, and we pray, O God, that you be with those that we lift quietly from our hearts in these moments. You know all of the needs. You know, O God, the petitions that we lift to you in this moment. We just pray, O God, that you be with each one, that they might know your healing presence, that they might know your healing touch, and just might know your hope anew. as you come to them and lift them up and draw them close to your Father's heart. We continue to pray for our country. We pray for our world. We pray for that day of peace, oh God, that Jesus told us will come. And we just pray that you'd help us to use not only Advent, but each day of our lives as a day of eager anticipation, looking for his return again, when that peace will ultimately be restored. We just pray now, God, that you be with us in our time of worship, that you might be glorified. We just commend ourselves to you, and we thank you and praise you for all that you are and for all that you've done for us. We just give our prayers to you now, even as we give ourselves, in the powerful name of your Son, Jesus. And, oh God, it's in his name that together we unite our voices, even as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Will the ushers please come forward?
give unto us, but especially the gift of your Son, Jesus. Accept now these our gifts we give back to you, O God, and we pray your blessing upon them, even as you bless us, that together we might be used to further your kingdom here on earth. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the word of the Lord.
Will you pray with me? Thank you, God, for your word. Thank you for the way that it teaches us. And by your Holy Spirit, O God, we pray that once again you would lead us deeper into that word, that we might grow in our relationship with you and each other, that we might grow to know your mercy and your hope, that truly we might be humble people. I pray now, O God, that you truly would hide you behind the cross of your Son Jesus. And in everything that is said and done, you would be the one seen. You would be the one heard. You would be the one glorified. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. For several weeks, we've been looking at what it means for us to be a people who are all in. We then shifted to a similar kind of theme as we're talking about what it means to come to the end of ourselves. We've been kind of using as a basis some of what Mark Batterson talks about, and then also what Kyle Eidelman talks about, and we even did a small group study that took us through four of the Beatitudes, but we're looking at all eight of the Beatitudes. And we continue to look at what does it mean for us to come to the end of ourselves, that we might better understand how we are to live our lives of faith and how we do that faithfully as good stewards. We saw in the first Beatitude, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And we saw there that the poor in spirit are those who recognize a sense of need in themselves. They recognize themselves as being less than what God calls them to become, and they seek to grow more and more into the likeness of Christ. We then considered the second of the Beatitudes, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. And we saw there that Jesus tells us that there will be times when we will mourn. He never promises us that everything's always going to be a bed of roses. There will be times when we will mourn. But he also tells us that in the midst of those times, God comes and comforts us as we trust him to see us through. Trusting in him and entrusting in his resources, instead of trusting in our own resources, which too often we try to do, and we miss that comfort that truly can be ours. We then looked at the third of the Beatitudes, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. And we saw here that the bottom line is that it all comes down to how we view ourselves, how we view others, and how we view God. And this one is closely tied to the first, in that it calls us to look at ourselves and how willing we are to humble ourselves. We then moved on to consider and to look at the fourth of the Beatitudes. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied, or they will be filled. We saw that righteousness is to choose, it's to reverence, it's to obey God as revealed in Jesus Christ. We saw that righteousness is love in action. It's doing the things that God would have us to do, and it's living our lives in accordance with God's will, not our will. Last week, we looked at and considered the fifth Beatitude, blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. And we saw there that a merciful person is one who is kind, one who is considerate, one who is compassionate, one who understands mercy, and who seeks to live a life that is merciful to others. They've received mercy, they understand it, and they want to share that mercy with others in the name of Christ. Now this morning we come to consider yet another of the Beatitudes, and it's blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Now, what does Jesus mean when he says pure in heart? In this Beatitude, the Greek word that is used here for pure is katharos. It means a number of things. It has a number of different meanings. They can range anywhere from things without blemish. Things without blemish, like food or drink or clothing, things like that. Things without blemish. It can also refer to blood lineage, a pure blood lineage. It can also refer to being ceremonial clean. And it can also refer to spiritual purity. Any number of those things it can be referring to. Now, in the ancient world, there were two conceptions of purity. One conception regarded purity as a matter of ritual observances. If I did all the right things, if I said all the right things and did all the right things, I would be pure. The other conception regarded purity as a matter of life and conduct, as well as a state of mind and a state of the heart. In Jesus' day, the first of these was what might be called the official orthodox conception of purity. The Jews felt that if they did all the right things, said all the right things, went through all the right motions, they were pure, ceremonially pure. But that's not what Jesus was talking about. And here comes Jesus, completely contradicting that thought and that belief, as he disassociates himself from that concept with these two words, as he says, "Blessed are the pure in heart." In heart. For Jesus, purity was not so much what we did on the outside. For Jesus, purity was an inward thing. It was a thing of the heart and of the mind and of the soul. On the Orthodox Jewish point of view, a person might have had within their heart thoughts of arrogance and pride, all kinds of things along those lines. But as long as they observed the outward rituals, they were pure. They were okay. Jesus' point of view comes from the totally opposite direction and sets itself at odds with what they believed. Because he says it doesn't make any difference how meticulous you are in all of your outward appearances and all the things that you're doing, if everything on the inside goes totally against that and is impure. It's been said we need not be too quick to condemn the Orthodox Jewish idea of purity as fantastically or obviously wrong. It is still possible to identify religion with outward observances. It is still possible to regard a person as religious because they observe all the outward conventions of religion: church-going, Christian liberality, Bible reading, respectability, pious language, and the list goes on. But it says, while in the eyes of Christ, that person is utterly irreligious, because the thoughts of their mind and the desires of their hearts will not bear the scrutiny of God. You see, there's a lot of folks that want to go around and they want to say the right things and they want to do all the right things. And sometimes I think we all fall into that kind of category. We want to convince ourselves that we are living a pure life because we do and say the right things. But God knows what's in our heart. He knows what's in our spirit. And he tells us that that's what matters most. So when Jesus speaks of purity, here's what he's talking about. He's saying to those who are listening as he taught, and to us today, that we need to go back and think about purity and how we're defining it. If we go back to its original Greek word, katharos, when it is used apart from ceremonial purity, we find that nearly all the other meanings of the word have one common element. They all describe something which has no tainting of anything else. That is, they have nothing in them that affects purity in any way. What we find is that when Jesus taught, "Blessed are the pure in heart," he meant, blessed are those whose thoughts and whose motives are absolutely unmixed, and therefore absolutely pure. Those who are pure in heart are those who truly love God and seek to live a life that is completely pleasing to Him. They are regenerated people who have God's glory as their main focus, not theirs. If you begin to see how all of these Beatitudes, they don't stand alone. They're all intertwined. Jesus is calling us to think about our inward motives. If we look to the scriptures, especially the Psalms, we find that they help us to better understand the meaning of this beatitude. In Psalm 24, it says to us, "Who may climb the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? Only those whose hands and hearts are pure, who do not worship idols and never tell lies. They will receive the Lord's blessing and have right standing with God, their Savior. They alone may enter God's presence and worship the God of Israel." David prayed in the 51st Psalm, "Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me again the joy of your salvation, and make me willing to obey you. Help me, O God, to have a pure and clean heart that has right motives. As I stand before you," we need to note that pure in heart is not used to indicate a morally perfect person, for no one is perfect, but rather a regenerated person who sincerely seeks to do God's will, in essence, one who's been made new in and by Christ. Jesus in this beatitude teaches us about the bliss of the one whose thoughts and motives and desires are completely unmixed, or genuine and sincere. It's been said that those who are pure in heart are redeemed people who, with singleness of mind and heart, are yielded to God, not to something else or someone else, but yielded to God with all on the altar, without reservation, without double-mindedness. Their purpose in life is to glorify God. You beginning to get the picture of what Jesus is asking for and teaching us about this beatitude and about purity? When we look at this beatitude and truly get in touch with what it's saying to us, we come to realize that it is probably one of the most, if not the most, demanding of the eight beatitudes. It necessitates the strictest and the most honest self-examination. And the end of that self-examination will almost without fail show us our shortcomings. And maybe that's why we don't want to do that self-examination. I don't want to see what's in there. I don't want to know what's in there. I don't want to deal with what's in there. But we need to do that. We need to be brutally honest with ourselves and with God. And we're never going to be able to do this until we come to the end of ourselves. And to be authentic before God. To be authentic with ourselves. To be authentic with others. What we all too often will find is that even when we start with pure motives and intentions, we can allow, if we're not careful, the residue of self-satisfaction or pride or a host of other motives to slip in, and they can begin to take over. Let's be honest. We all know how to put on a good show on the outside, and we might even come across as a saint to those that are around us. But deep within, when we do an honest and self-examination of ourselves, we find that we are like Paul, who proclaimed, "I am the chief of all sinners." There is no way to the purity that this beatitude demands other than coming to the end of ourselves. Dying to self, and as we do, coming to new life in Christ. When we do this, Paul says we are set free. And he describes it this way in Romans 6, starting with verse 5. Since we have been united with him in his death, we will also be raised as he was. Our old sinful selves were crucified with Christ so that sin might lose its power in our lives. We are no longer slaves to sin. For when we died with Christ, we were set free from the power of sin. And since we died with Christ, we know that we will also share in his new life. And when we do that, we can come to that place where we not only understand purity of heart, we can begin to live it. The call here is for us to understand the need for purity of heart, to be seeking purity of heart, and to live our lives out of a purity of heart. The promise of this beatitude is truly a powerful one. Jesus says, "Blessed are the pure in heart." Why? For they will see God. They will see God. Now we need to understand that this promise that the pure in heart shall see God is not a promise necessarily that they will see God with their physical eyes, but rather they will experience the reality of God and can and will see him with their spiritual eyes. Jesus said to Nicodemus, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. That is, enter into it, experience the reality of it, to see it and experience it. Now the promise that the pure in heart shall see God is twofold. One, they will see him in heaven. They will see him in heaven. This is certainly a part of the promise, although not the whole of it. Jesus promised that his disciples, those that are pure in heart, will be with him, will be with him in the heavenly home forever. One of the best known passages of scripture that oftentimes is used, and rightfully so, in celebrations of life when one has come to the end of life here on this earth and has passed to that life with the Lord, is found in the Gospel of John in the 14th chapter, where Jesus says, don't be troubled. You trust God, now trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's home, and I am going to prepare a place for you. If this were not so, I would tell you plainly, when everything is ready, I will come and I will get you so that you will always be with me where I am. And David boldly proclaimed in the 23rd Psalm that not only did he know that the Lord was his shepherd, but because he knew the Lord was his shepherd, he said, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. They will see him in heaven. The second, they will see him now. They will see him now. They are those who experience him by faith. The idea is that they will keep on experiencing God. The pure in heart are those who see God in their Christian experience. They see him as they actively live out their life of faith, always seeking to draw closer to God and to his people. The normal experience of the pure in heart is that they just know in their hearts the reality of God. And they see that reality all around them. Those who are pure in heart that see God find these things. That God helps them understand humility. God helps them to understand humility. Those who are pure in heart, who see God, no longer look at themselves in a way as they did before. They see themselves through God's eyes, and they understand that they are sinners saved by His grace. This is exactly what happened to Paul. That's why he was proclaiming, "I am the chief of all sinners." But Paul also knew that he was made new in Christ. That he was a new creation, that the old had passed away. God helps them understand humility. Another is they are motivated to service. When one sees God and experiences His presence, they cannot help but want to serve God and His people. It just becomes a natural part of that process. And third and finally, they have a change in life's priorities. One who is pure in heart is one who has had a complete change in their life priorities. Their affections are now set on heavenly goals, not on earthly goals. And again, as we become new in Christ, we shift the things that are important to us to the things they're heavenly and not so much earthly. So Jesus says, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God." And He wants the people that He's talking to in that day and time, and He wants us to understand as He speaks those same words to us today. That we need to quit worrying about all the things that we do on the outside. And He's not trying to say that worship and prayer and reading our Bible and all those things aren't important. They are. But what really counts is the motivation that lies underneath for why we're doing those things. And how we're growing closer and closer to the Lord Jesus Christ each day of our lives. Advent is a season of anticipation. It's a season when we look to the coming of Christ again. And as we're pure in heart, we look to see if we're prepared to receive Him anew. And so, my friends, I pray that as we come to Holy Communion this morning, it becomes a time for us to look deep within. But it likewise becomes a time for us to celebrate anew the wonder of God's love and God's grace that redeems us and makes us new creations in Christ, so that we can be pure in heart. And so today in Holy Communion, we celebrate what God has done for us in Christ, that which we could not do for ourselves. And we come to His table celebrating anew His grace that redeems us and gives us that opportunity to be pure in heart, that we might truly, truly, truly see God. Will you pray with me? Oh God, we give You thanks and praise for Your Son, Jesus Christ, who came that we might have life, who came that we might know forgiveness, who came that we might know a relationship, a very personal relationship with You. We pray, O God, that You'd help us as we come to this Your table to truly allow You by Your Holy Spirit to help us to examine our hearts, our minds, our very spirits, that we might look at the motivations behind how we live our lives. And that You help us to discover those places where those motivations are not pure. And as we discover those things, oh God, those places where we need to change, may we be humble enough to allow You by Your Holy Spirit to cleanse us and to make us new. We give You thanks and praise for this blessed sacrament. that calls us to remember all that Christ has done for us. We pray that as we come to this table, you would help us truly to celebrate anew, not only his coming that first time, but to look again for his coming anew, that we might be with you forever. We thank you, O God, for this blessed promise, that blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Bless these elements now, O God, and we who come to partake of them, as we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I'm going to ask the communion students if they would come forward. This is an open communion. It's open to any and all. We're going to be receiving communion in the pews. We'll be passing the elements. We'd ask that you would hold them until all have received, that we might partake together. The night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread at that table, and he gave thanks for it, and then he broke it. And he said, "This is my body that is given for you. I want you to take and eat this, and when you do, I want you to remember me." We eat the bread together in remembrance of Christ. Thank you. Likewise, Jesus took the cup, and again he gave thanks. And he said, this is my blood. It's the blood of the new covenant that is shed for each and every one of you, so that you might know that your sins are forgiven, that you might know newness of life. He said, take and drink it. And as often as you do, remember me. We drink the cup in remembrance of Christ. We give you thanks and praise, O God, again for the gift of your Son, Jesus. He truly showed us that it means to be merciful. We just pray, O God, that you'd help us to likewise take the lesson from him of what it means to be pure in Christ. We pray, O God, that you help us to go forth from this table, allowing you by your Holy Spirit to guide and lead us all of our days, that we might not only be pure in heart, but in so doing, that we might see God. We ask these things now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh,
16th.